Is the sound okay? And can you see the presentation?
Yeah, we can hear you great, and it looks good, mate. We'll see the first slide of your presentation.
Perfect. Let's just remove this one. Okay, hi everybody, and welcome on this Integration Monday session. My name is Toon van Oten, and tonight I'm going to talk about BizTalk application lifecycle management. Thanks for joining the session, and also thanks to the Integration Monday team for having me tonight. So I'm Toon van Oten. I'm an integration architect with Codit. Codit is an integration company focusing on integration on the Microsoft stack, so that means mostly Microsoft BizTalk server and also the Microsoft Azure Cloud, where we do also a lot of integration. I have more than 9 years experience with Microsoft integration. I'm a certified trainer, and during my years of integration work on the field, I gained a specific interest for application lifecycle management and B2B communication. I'm also an AS4 Oasis committee member, so AS4 is a new B2B messaging protocol. It's the successor, let's say, of AS2. On the agenda for today, first of all, a kind of a scope for this session. Then we're going to talk a bit on integration, continuous integration. And then I would like to get really hands-on, so some demos on unit testing, builds, deployments, and integration testing. So the scope for today is on continuous integration and more the technical side of BizTalk application lifecycle management. The session will be fully covered by community software. So I know there are products out there that you can buy, but this will be a session based on free community software. It's an on-premise session, but if you use Visual Studio Online, the approach is rather similar because you still need a kind of build agent on-premise or somewhere in a virtual machine on the cloud. And here's also a non-exhaustive list of things that will not be covered in this session because application lifecycle management is a very broad picture. So we're not going to talk about all the team foundation structure, server details, branching, versioning, automatic release notes, load testing, and so on. These things will not be covered in this session and maybe could be covered in different sessions on application lifecycle. Existing pain points we often hear from the fields. A developer who wants to make a copy of the pipeline component because he doesn't dare to touch it because it's used in too many flows. That he's scared of doing some breaking changes. I've seen it many times at some customers. Also, developers who are uncertain to change a complex flat file schema. As you all might know, a flat file schema, if you change one setting, it could be that your whole schema is broken. So therefore, you need to have a kind of visibility on if you did break a schema, yes or no. And the only way you can do this is via unit testing with a lot of sample files, sample instances of a flat file. A third thing that could occur is that when you regenerate a schema, that you often forget to update the property promotion. So generated schemas, afterwards you maybe do some manual task on them, you add context properties, or you maybe configure the schema for debugging. When you regenerate that schema, it's often forgotten, and that will also break after a deployment. And BizTalk deployments, as we all know, can be very complex, and sometimes too complex for the operations team. So the development team needs to spend a lot of time, in many cases, spending their time on releasing the software on the integration environment, on test environments, acceptance, staging, and production environments. Also, the customer or maybe the project manager has some existing pain points. They can't afford a long downtime on production environment for deployments, so the deployment window should be as short as possible. All bugs often return in further releases, and this kind of regression is unacceptable. So it's not really professional having bugs that are returning into production. So once you have a bug and you solve it, they should be banned from a production environment. And the last thing, the business needs to change fast. So also with your integration layer, and you need to react fast upon that. So the better application lifecycle management you have, the faster you can fulfill the needs of the business. So if you have a look at application lifecycle management in general, it consists of four phases: analysis, development, release, and maintenance. Of course, it's a cycle, and today we will focus on the development slash release part of application lifecycle management. But this just to show you that application lifecycle management is more than what I will cover in this session. I will focus mainly on continuous integration, and that's a software methodology which is focused on a central code repository, for example, Team Foundation Server. And it makes use of daily check-ins, so the developers check in their codes on a daily basis. And from that central code repository, build automation, automatic testing, and automatic deployment is triggered. So it's the intention to have a repeatable process if you set up continuous integration. This comes with a lot of advantages. You detect bugs in an early stage, and mostly you detect them already in an automated way, so without people needing to test it in a manual way. The quality of your delivery will increase significantly, and you will also have a faster release cycle. Of course, it comes also with some downsides. You need to invest in it, so it comes with an initial setup, an extra cost on hardware and software, and of course your continuous integration solution needs to be continuously maintained. So for every project, we need to ask ourselves the question, what's the return on investment, and how much will we invest on application lifecycle management and continuous integration? I'm convinced that at least for every single project, there should be a minimum of continuous integration. And that means at least having a central code repository, an automatic build, and also automatic unit testing. That should be the bare minimum for every project. And depending on the size or the impact of a certain project, you can increase that continuous integration. You don't need to start with a full-blown continuous integration from your first release, but it can grow together with your software. If we bring it all together, BizTalk Server, continuous integration, and application lifecycle management, I think we all know that it's rather a challenge. There's no out-of-the-box support for BizTalk Server within Team Foundation Server, so we will need to customize the build workflow in order to fulfill all our needs. There's no out-of-the-box BizTalk deployment tool, so we should buy a tool, do it ourselves, or use community tools. In this session, we will focus on the community tools part. The granularity of deployment is also very important. You need to think upfront on the impact of certain deployments. So you need to determine a fine-grained solution structure and also an application structure. And the last topic is that BizTalk solutions are very tough to test. So you can do a lot of unit testing, but the best way to test a BizTalk environment is done via integration testing. So integration testing means testing in an automated way, preferably on a deployed BizTalk environment. So using your context properties, using your message box, your content-based routing. For this session, I prepared a real-life scenario. You can find here the flow overview over this scenario. We start here on the left with an ERP system, which will be a SQL database. And we will have a receive location pulling on the ERP system database. And in the receive pipeline, the message will be debugged. Every single message will go to a generic orchestration, which is the routing orchestration. And depending on the content of the message, it will set the destination context properties. The message is published on the message box, and then the invoices for codeit are sent to the codeit send port, where they will be transformed into a flat file and put on disk. Invoices for Microsoft will be just passed through on disk, but the file name will contain the reference of the invoice. And the invoices for Northwind will first need to go to the currency converter, where we will convert the US dollar into euros. And once that is done, the response of the web service, the currency converter web service, is merged with the original invoice and sent out also to the file system. On the left side, we have the biztalk.demo.alm.core application, which is our generic application. So it's often the case in many projects that you have common BizTalk applications. And on the right, we have a specific invoicing application. And the invoicing application references has an application reference to the core application because it uses, for example, the schema, the invoice schema, which is deployed over here. Let's have a look now on the virtual machine over here at the scenario. So if I go now to the SQL Server, you see here I have a bunch of invoices, 10 invoices over here. I can update their status to new, so they will be picked up by a BizTalk receive location. And then if I select them, we should see the status changing to done, and indeed, so it's done. If you have then a look in our queue, we have several folders per environment a folder. Currently we are on the dev environments. So if I look on the dev environments, and look in the code folder, we see three flat files being generated. In the Microsoft folder, we see two files and they contain the reference of the invoice. So if you have a look here, the reference was ref 1 to 3 and 5, 4, 6. So we have stripped out the reference from the file name. And also in the Northwind, we have three invoices. So in total, we have our 10 invoices that were debugged. Next thing I would like to show you is about unit testing. And unit tests are tests that are running on your code base. So you don't need a deployed BizTalk application to run your tests. And it's very good to know and sometimes hard to convince developers of that. But unit tests are not only there to increase the quality, but also to increase your productivity as a developer. You can use them really as a developer tool. For example, how hard is it to test, for example, a pipeline component? You need to add the pipeline component to the pipeline components folder. Then it is mostly locked by the BizTalk host instance, so you need to stop it, copy the pipeline component, start your host instance again. So all these tasks are very time-consuming. The same if you want to test, for example, the flat file schema. If you can mock everything, let's say, within a unit test, your productivity as a developer will increase a lot. Second, good practice is to create data-driven unit tests. In the example, I will show you a flat file schema that I will test against 10 flat file instances. Because flat files can sometimes be very complex and you need to make sure that you cover every scenario of the flat file. It's also good to create at least one unit test per bug that is discovered in your production environment. In that way, you avoid regression errors. And don't only focus on the happy parts, but also focus on negative testing. The next slides are there more for your reference because I will demonstrate them in Visual Studio. But I will create a data-driven unit test for flat file schemas using the Winterdome schema tester. I will use the BizTalk mock test framework, which is available on CodePlex and GitHub, to test specific scenarios on mapping. And I will show you how to test a BizTalk pipeline component, again using the Winterdome pipeline tester. So now let's go to our solution. And here in the right, we see our solution. So it contains of three projects, one unit test project and one integration test project. Let's focus first on the unit tests. And here I will show you first the testing of the schema. What I have here, I'm using the Winterdome.pipeline testing assembly. And it's good to see that here my test method is decorated with a data source. The data source refers to a TXT file, to a CSV. And this is how the CSV looks like. It contains all the paths of the sample messages I want to validate against the schema. In this way, I only need to write my unit test once, but it is executed for every instance, every path that is listed in my TXT file. So what I do, I just open a file stream with my data row. I create an output message by using the Winterdome schema tester, provides my flat file schema, and parse the input message against the flat file. if this will fail, it will throw an exception. You could use the message helper to catch that exception, and maybe in order to test your schema also in invalid cases. So if I now right click and click on run tests, the solution will be built, and afterwards the test should execute and hopefully, of course, successfully. So the solution is currently building. I see that my machine is a bit slower than usual, so I hope we'll not run into problems. And the test has discovered, and it will run now. So you see the test schema has run successfully. You see one passed test, but if you look at the details, you see multiple occurrences of the same test. So this is a data-driven test. If I need to add new sample messages to my test, I just need to update here this txt file. So very simple way of extending one unit test towards multiple instances of a sample. The second thing I would like to show you is how to use the BizTalk mob test framework in order to use your tests. First, you need to create a test class. You need to implement the mopping fixture. This will return, first of all, a testable mop base. So this is your mopping, and it's important that you need to enable unit testing on your mops. So here in the properties, you need to set enable unit testing to true. Two things you need to return. You need to first return the source path base. So this is actually the input file for your mopping, and also the expected result or output file. If I run now the base test, I execute base test, what will it do? It will just take this input file, apply this mopping, and compare the result with this result file. So nothing special about that. We can also do that with the normal Microsoft assemblies available for unit testing. But this framework has more features, and one of the features I'll show you is you can add test cases. So you can make variations of this input message. You can, for example, say, I create here a new test case where I would like to change my inputs, and I will change the status of my input message, and then I will check the results of my output message. So if I change the status of my input message, I want to see the behavior of my output message of the success node. So in this case, I had two test cases. If the input message has a status OK, then the output message should have the success node true. If my input message contains a not OK, then my success should be false. And then you can just execute the tests and provide the different scenarios, the different test cases to that method. So I can run this test to see if this succeeds. In the meantime, I can explain another feature of this mop test framework. For example, with a lot of moppings, you generate automatically a new GUID, or you generate the current datetime. And then it becomes very difficult to compare it with an existing result file, because the datetime will always be different. So this framework allows you to, just before the comparison, to make sure that you can make your output of your mop independent of the generated GUID or of the generated datetime. And you see here the test map status has completed successfully. Then a last one I would like to show you is how you can test a pipeline component or a pipeline. They are very similar to each other. Again, using the Winterdome pipeline testing assembly. So here on the fly, you can create an empty receive pipeline. I create an instance of my copy property pipeline component, and I configure my properties as I would do at design time. So what does this property, copy property component do? It copies a context property from to the to, and you can apply a regular expression on it. So you can strip out the desired behavior of the from property, and only that result will be promoted into the to party. Here I add the component to my receive pipeline. I create an input message just from the file stream. And then I add already a context property to my input message, which is the reference, and it contains a reference ref123. Then I'll execute my pipeline, I provide my input message, and what I get is an array of output messages. It's an array because you could have debugging in your receive pipeline, so you could have multiple output messages. Then I read from the first output message the context property received file name, which was the to property, and that one should be equal with 123 because I wanted to extract here the part after the ref. So let's just trigger this test, run tests, and this test should run. As said, you can also use this one for debugging, so it's good if you configured your schema for debugging that you also create a unit test for it. You can just provide a batch message to your unit test and check if the number of output messages is as expected. So very simple, but if you then in the future forget to update, let's say, your batching of the schema, it will be covered by your unit tests. And you see here the property promotion tests ran also successfully. Let's go back to the slides. Now I did manual unit testing. Now it's time to automate this into a continuous build. So developers check in their code into source control. And from that source control, we will trigger a build workflow which gets the latest code base, which will compile the sources, and then we'll run the unit tests on these compiled sources. So let's have a look how we can do this in Visual Studio. I need to go to the Team Explorer, and I'll create a new build definition. Let's give it a meaningful name, integration-monday.alm.invoicing.continuous. As a trigger, I will keep it manually, but in a normal scenario, I would use continuous integration or maybe gated check-in, which is more strict and only allows your codes to be checked in if the build ran successfully. But otherwise, I will trigger constantly builds, and that's also not the purpose. I need to specify the source settings, so what source needs to be downloaded on the build agent in order to build my projects. First of all, I'll need this build folder. This folder contains several PowerShell scripts which are not required currently, but I will need them later on, so I'll configure them already. Next thing I'll need is my sources. So I take here my starter sources. Although I only want to build my invoicing application, I also need to build the core solution because it depends on it. So that's why I specify here the starter as a source control folder. Then the build defaults, I need to provide here the output folder for the build. I've put it here aside. So this is my build output on the UNC paths. And then the most important part is the configuration of the template. In this session I will use a default template for TFS 2013. First thing I will configure is the projects to build. So by default he proposes already the project I'm currently working on, so the ALM.invoicing solution, but I also need my core solution to be built because we're depending on that. So I go to the core solution and select that solution. I put it as the first one because it depends, and then the invoicing can be built. Another important setting is here in the advanced tab. We need to specify the MS Build platform to x86. It's very important, otherwise you will get exceptions. And the last thing, I want to run my unit tests. So I have here one test already specified, but I will edit it because currently it will run every test in every test assembly, but I only want to run my unit tests, so I will change this one with unit tests. So it will only discover the tests in assemblies that contain the word unit test. It's also good to configure your builds to fail. If the test fails, you can give this test run a meaningful name, for example, units tests, like this. Let's click OK. And also OK over here. Let's save this and let's trigger the build to see what happens. Queue new builds. We queue it. And here we can follow up on the details. It's also important to note, if you add solutions to your source control or projects, don't add the automatically generated CS classes. So if you build, for example, a pipeline or a schema, BizTalk will generate some code behind, so the CS file, but that one should not be checked in your source control. Otherwise, during the build, you will get locks and so on. So that's something I would like to give as a tip. So you see, the build agent has been reserved. First thing that now will happen is the sources will be downloaded on the build agent. Currently, everything is running on the single test machine, but in a real environment, it's good to split, of course, your build agent from your BizTalk server itself, because otherwise, yeah, you can get in troubles with the global assembly cache while executing your unit test, for example. So you see the MS build has triggered, so we have some typical warnings. The core application has been built. Now the invoicing application has also been built. And now it's time that the test should run, hopefully at least. Indeed, the test ran. And I'm happy because the build succeeded. And if you look at the test run, we had 100% pass rate. 12 unit tests were executed. And if you look at the details, you see we had some unit tests and, of course, our data-driven tests, which accounts for more than one test. So back to the slides. Next thing I would like to do, I want to automate the deployments. There are several options available for deployments. You can use the standard BizTalk MSI and deployment libraries. You could use the BizTalk deployment framework, which is available on Codeplex. There's also an MS Build extension pack for BizTalk. There's also a cool thing, which is BTS MSI task, where you can generate during the build BizTalk compatible MSIs. And also with Codeit, we have our own generic framework, deployment framework, and our ALM suite. So that one could be used for complex scenarios. It doesn't only offer a backend, but also a frontend to visualize the state of all your releases across your environments. For this session, I would like to focus on community software, and I have picked the BTDF, which is most commonly used, I guess, amongst the community. Some features of the BizTalk deployment framework. You can create a BizTalk deployment framework MSI during your build. So it's a custom MSI. It's not the same MSI as you have a standard BizTalk MSI. Binding file management, so the variables across your environments, is done via Excel. If required, you can automate your deployment via PowerShell, which we will cover in this session. Also, versioning will be covered. Deployment is typically done on BizTalk application level, and it's an extensible framework, so you can configure it to your needs. Let's have a look how we can configure BTDF for this application or solution. Once you have installed BTDF, you can add the BizTalk deployment framework project. And first thing it will do, it will ask you some settings. And I will disable two settings, deploy orchestrations and deploy transforms. Why will I do this? Because the BTDF works in the best way if you, let's say, split your artifact types in different assemblies. So you have an assembly for your schemas, one for your maps, one for your pipelines, and one for your orchestrations. If you don't do this, which is in my scenario the case, you should configure your assembly as a schema assembly, and then the BTDF will work correctly. So although I will deploy transforms and orchestrations, because they are within the same assemblies, I will treat them as schemas. So that's why I put them to false. You can also specify some settings on how to deploy. For example, if you don't want to start IIS, for example, you can skip it. You can create a project. So the deployment project has been created, but you see that nothing has been added over here. So I'll need to add existing items to my, in my case, I will add it to the solution items. So you see a deployment folder has been created, and all these files are required for the BizTalk deployment framework to work. The most important file is here, this in this build project file. I'll zoom in a bit. First of all, you can do some general settings. I'll add some interesting settings. For example, the auto-terminate instances. This is there to kill any suspended instances that are available on your message box before deployment. Otherwise, your deployment will fail. Another cool thing that you can do is you can specify the BizTalk application description. And what I commonly like to do is use this MSBuild macro over here to put in the application description the time when it was deployed, so you have at least some visibility on that. The next property group you can configure is about your MSI specific. So you can change the version, the product version, if you want to, but we will do that in the next topic in an automated way. You can put the manufacturer, for example, to code it, and so on. And then next thing you need to do is, here you see the big to-do. This is something you need to configure for your own project. I've prepared already the configuration to go a bit faster. Let me just copy paste this. So the first item group I have here is the BizTalk hosts I would like to restart, because it could be that your application only depends on one or two hosts or host instances, but you have maybe seven of them specified in your environment. So if you don't want every host instance to be restarted, you can include or exclude here hosts. Another very important thing is, this is the invoicing application I would like to deploy. So I'll need an application reference to the ALM.core solution. So that's why I add the apps to reference. So the BTDF knows he needs to put an application reference to that application. And then, as already said, the assemblies, we have three assemblies I would like to add to the MSI. I can configure them over here, and I'll treat them as schema assemblies because they contain a mix of BizTalk artifact types. So I save this one. Next thing I would like to do, I would like to configure my binding file, and this is done via a templated file, which is the port bindings master. Currently this one is empty, so I'll copy the file path over here, and I will export my current bindings of my current solution. So we have one receive location and four send ports and one orchestration over here. So I will export these bindings to that location, click yes and override it. And if I now return to Visual Studio, you will see an update of the binding file, and you see multiple send ports over here. If we have a look at the details of the send ports, we see here that the folder where we drop the messages, the output message, contains an environment-specific value, because for acceptance, this should be acceptance, and for test, this should contain the value test. So this is my template, so I can put here a variable, environment, and I can do this for every of the three send ports we have. So here also, make sure, don't make a mistake, over here, yes, and then the last one, over here, change this one, and we save this. So now we have added a variable to our template. You can also use this for connection strings, maybe passwords, and so on. And then in the settings file generator, which is an Excel file. So I'll open it with Excel. You can specify the value of that property for every specific environment. So Excel is opening. So I'll add here environments. I'll just remove the overhead. Yeah. The default value, just blah, blah, blah. For the local environments, it must contain the value dev. Also for the shared development environment, dev. For the test environment, I would like to have ACK. And for the production, it should contain prod. I can save this file. And the last thing I would like to show you is here the installvisits.xml. Here you can extend or modify, let's say, the behavior, the visual aspect of your MSI installation. And for example, this prompt for the account name for the BizTalk host instance, I will delete it because I don't need it for my project. I can just delete it this way. So now I configured everything, but of course, I would like to know if I've done everything correct. The best way to test this is via the tools, BizTalk deployment framework, and you choose here build deploy MSI. So what this will do, it will build your deployment framework project and it will try to generate an MSI. If you misconfigured something, you should get an exception over here. Otherwise, you should have an MSI created. And as I see so far, everything goes smooth. So in the meantime, while we're waiting, I will check in the changes. I didn't provide a comment, sorry for that. And you see the deployment files are added. If I now go to the File Explorer, in the deployments bin debug, we should have here an MSI created. So this is the BTDF specific MSI. Before I will deploy this application manually, I first need to delete this application because the MSI doesn't support that out of the box. So if you want an automatic undeployment of your application, you need to do that via PowerShell, which we will cover in the next section. So delete the ALM.invoicing application. And now I can start my deployments. I right mouse click install, click next. I accept the license agreement, keep the default paths, click install. Then important to check, start deploying to BizTalk, and then MS Build kicks off. First thing the wizard asks me is to which environment do you want to deploy, so which environment settings should we apply. So this is the dev environment. I click next. Need to specify this is the last server in the BizTalk group. So if you have a high available environment with multiple BizTalk servers, the MSI or the assemblies only need to be imported once. So that's why you need to specify which one is the last server in your BizTalk group. So I click finish and you see he started creating the BizTalk application over here. And maybe we can follow on real time over here. So we see the BizTalk.demo.invoicing application has been created. If you look at the properties, you should see the timing that it's pretty recently. If you have a look at the receive locations, none of them are created. So I think they're still adding assemblies. Yeah. Now the import bindings is executed, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. You see now that the host instance is being restarted, so it can take a while. And after the host instance restarts, the application will be started. Okay, so you see right now the receive location should be started and also the send ports should be started. So our deployment, manual deployment went successfully. Let's get back to the slides. Next thing I would like to do is to create a new build, which will deploy automatically and will also apply versioning. So the intention is to customize the build workflow to apply first versioning and then to perform a deployment. We want to do a deployment because afterwards we would like to test on the deployed environment. The purpose of this build workflow is also that it will create an independent deploy package that can be released on the acceptance and production environment, for example. So let's have a look how we can do this. Let's go to Visual Studio, the build up. And it will create a new build definition, but I will not start from scratch. I will clone the existing one. This is available if you install the TFS power tools. So it's important to have a continuous build and a deployment build because it's the intention to keep your continuous build very slow, so the very short, my apologies, to have a fast release and a fast acknowledgement of your unit tests. And for example, this deployment and integration testing build can be scheduled at night, for example, and then it doesn't matter if it takes 10 or 15 minutes. I need to change the process template over here. The first thing I would like to do is I need to add the BizTalk project to the items to build because we need to generate the MSI during the build. So I'll add the invoicing deployment framework project, and that's an MS build project file. So I'll add it over here, and that's fine. Another thing I need to do is I need to put my output location to as configured. This is required for the BTDF to generate the MSI. The as configured means that you run the build as you would run it in Visual Studio. The only disadvantage of this setting is that your build output will be empty by default, so we will need to have a PowerShell script that copies the required files to the build output. So here in the advanced part of the builds, we have a pre-build script, and here I will configure a PowerShell script which will apply versioning. Details on the script will follow later on while I trigger the build. We have a post-build script, so after the build succeeded, we need to copy the files to the build output, to the drop folder. So I created also a script for that. And then as a last one, before we will run the tests, I would like to do a deployment. So I have here a pre-test script path. And here I have the deploy PowerShell. I'll save this solution. And before going to trigger the build, I'm going to show you here the build folder where we have all the PowerShell scripts and we have an applications.txt file. And here I keep track of the versions. So for example, for the invoicing now I want the version 6. Oh, that's not the intention. Okay, my numlock 6.5.4, for example. I'll save this. I need to check it in, of course. And these values will be used by my PowerShell scripts in order to apply versioning. So I will trigger this build. In reality, this should be triggered automatically by night, for example. I'll just wait a second to see if the build kicks off successfully, and then I'll return to the PowerPoint to explain the PowerShell scripts I configured. Deployment can also be done through TFS Lab Management. You should definitely have a look at it. It has a good experience for deployment, but it has a lot of overhead for testing. Every automated test should be linked to a test case and so on, so it has some overhead on that level. So the deployment is started, so it will undeploy the invoicing application and redeploy it again. Now first go to the slides. I configured three scripts, so I'll explain them one by one. The first one is the update version script, and all scripts are based on biztalk-alm.codeplex.com, a very good guidance on how to set set up BizTalk application lifecycle management. So the first thing we will do before the build, we will update the MSI version in the BTDF file and also generate a new GUID. After we have installed that new MSI, you will see, hopefully, in the programs and features that the version of the MSI of the installed application increased. Also, before we build the sources, we will update the assembly file info for every corresponding assembly, and we will update it to the version specified in the applications.txt, and it will be extended here by the build number, so we have a unique assembly file version for every assembly that is generated. The next script is the copy files to drop folder, and remember that we configured the output location as configured in order to have the BTDF MSI created. The disadvantage is that we will have an empty build output. So in order to solve that, I configured this PowerShell script as a post-build event. It will copy all the necessary assemblies to the build output, and it will also generate a deploy package, which is a separate folder containing all the MSIs that have been created and a deployment script that can be used to roll out this MSI on further environments. Then the last script is the deployment script itself. It deploys all the MSIs in the package, so if you have 5 MSIs, it will deploy all 5 MSIs. It will take into account application references, which means if you have a referencing application, it will be undeployed and deployed again. And if that referencing application is not in your package, it will have a look in the archive location to find there the latest package. So if we have this archive location, we have a deploy package that contains the 4 version of the core application, and we have currently in BizTalk the invoicing application, which has a reference to the core. What will happen? We will undeploy first the invoicing application because it has a reference, then undeploy the core application, then we will deploy the MSI of the deploy package, then we will deploy the invoicing application. The MSI was not in the deploy package, so we take the latest version of the archive. And once this was successfully, we will update the archive with the latest version of the core application. In order to have this automation, we have 3 environment variables. So the PowerShell script knows which environment we are running, so it knows which environment settings to use. It knows where the archive is located, and it knows if it should deploy to BizTalk, yes or no. This is required for the high available environment. Let's have a look at the tests, and I'm very happy because the test succeeded. If you look at the drop folder of this build, you can right click on an assembly, you go to the properties, and here in the details, we see that the version indeed increased. So that's good to see. We have also a deploy package over here, an independent deploy package with the versioned MSI. And if you have a look in the programs and features, I'll do an update over here. It can sometimes take a while. We should see today. Here that we have the version 6.5.4 deployed now on our BizTalk environment. So this is already a full-blown deployment from triggered from the builds. Last thing I would like to show you is how we can set up now integration testing. So I deployed during the build in order to be able to test my BizTalk environments with the message box included, so really the deployed environment. The biggest problem is that not all backend systems are available for testing. For example, on the dev environment, we don't have the ERP system. Luckily, we have the web service because we developed it ourselves, but we don't have the file paths, for example. So in many cases, you need to have a kind of a stubbing mechanism or a mocking mechanism. And lately, I discovered on Codeplex a very cool tool, which is called Transmock. It's recently been published, so not that famous anymore. So that's why I would like to point to this very interesting tool. How does it work? It consists of 2 parts, the Transmock framework. First of all, it has a mockifier, which will mockify your binding file. So this is a console application. And what you need to do in your binding file, you need to add a comment to every receive location or send port you want to have the mock adapter installed, and the mockifier will automatically update your binding file, so the mock adapter is installed on all ports you have selected. The next thing you can do is you need to communicate, of course, with that mock adapter, and that can be done through a biz unit test. So we have a biz unit test case, and there you can have a mock send step, which you can use to send a message to the mock adapter of that receive location. In that case, you will just inject a message into the BizTalk runtime. It will go over the message box. It will flow to the currency converter. And at the end, it will go to the mock adapter of this invoicing send port. And we will have a mock receive step that will listen, will wait for a callback for a message received by that send port. And in this way, you have a very cool way to test your integration, to do your integration testing without having all your backend systems available. So you install in a very easy way the mock adapter on every required port, and you interact with that mock adapter from within a BizUnit test case. It's good to know that it also works for request response, so you can receive a request, you can even validate it because you have everything available from the BizUnit framework, and depending on the request you can send a different response, so you can generate dynamically different test cases. Let's have a look how we can do this for our solution. First of all, I need to tell the mockifier which ports I would like to mock. I would like to have mocked this send port. So I need to add a comment like this, mock, just a tag. And I will also add this to my receive location. Just need to put it on the right location over here. Yes. And I'll save this one. Now I can give this binding file to the mockifier, which is a console application, and this will replace this receive location with a mock adapter. But it's even more cool, it has an extension for BTDF that does it out of the box for you. So if you update your deployment project and you import here a custom transmock task, it will mockify your binding file only for your dev and your local environment. So that's something which is rather hard-coded in your transmock task. But this one will replace this port with the mock adapter. Let's have a look. I will not deploy now via the build because it will take me maybe too long. But I can deploy via the tools and deploy BizTalk application. So this is the quick deployment while you're in development. It will delete the application and so on, so cool things. First, I will check in again the pending changes that I don't forget this. No comment anymore. Pretty naughty today. And then let's have a look at the BizTalk ALM.invoicing application. You see it has been deployed from scratch, so there are no receive locations as we speak. Yeah, now I have the outputs available. Okay, sometimes you have this issue as well, he's deploying. And hopefully I should see here a receive location configured with the mock adapter. I don't dare to click anymore because everybody knows the BizTalk admin console. It likes to freeze. Yeah. So we have the receive location. It's still disabled because deployment is in progress. But you can see here that the mock adapter is being configured. It's a custom binding. If we look at the configuration of it, it has a mock address. It has just the mock binding configured, not that many properties. You can configure also promoted properties if required. And important to see that it uses Base64 encoding, so you can also, although it uses WCF, you can use also flat files and so on, or PDFs. Behind the scenes, I've seen in the source that it uses name pipes to do the communication behind the scenes. Also, my send port should be configured with the mock adapter over here. If I now go to my integration test project, which is over here, I prepared already a test. It creates a BizUnit test case. We will add a mock send step and we will send this XML to this receive location. This is just a static behind the receive location. It just contains the URI of the mock adapter. We send this XML, we add this send step to the execution steps. Next, we will kind of host an endpoint within our test to wait for the response, and the response will be asynchronously received via a mock receive step where we will listen on messages originating from the send port, so from that URI. We also add this step and run the BizUnit test. If I right click on this and test this one, it should hopefully go successful. The test run has started. And indeed, it ran successfully. Of course, you can say that's easy, but if I go to the tracked message events over here, we should see that we received a message on the mock adapter over here. Then the web service, so the local host currency converter, was called, and at the end, our mock adapter was triggered, and the message was received in our unit test. So a very cool way to automate and to mock your integration tests. So now I'm at almost the end of my presentation. What I would like to show you now is the full-blown scenario where we do also after our deployment an integration test. And I will try to show it with a negative scenario where me as a developer, I'll do something I wouldn't say stupid because everybody can make a mistake, but I will update upon requests the core solution. So we have here the core solution. And I need to regenerate the SQL schema because a new field has been added, a new record has been added to the database. But while doing that update, I forget to configure the context properties. So the context properties are not there anymore. So we have here the schema. Instead of regenerating it, I will just remove the context properties just to have a faster feedback on that one. I'll check in this change. Yes, no comments, that's not good. What I now will do, I will trigger another build, which is a build that deploys everything. So it will deploy, so what will this build do? It will undeploy the invoicing application, undeploy the core application, deploy the modified core application which will contain a mistake. It will deploy the invoicing application, it will run the integration tests on it, and I hope that the integration tests will fail because of my regenerated schema which doesn't contain the context properties, I should have a routing failure. Intention of this scenario, I'll keep this just open because it will take, I guess, 5 minutes or something like that, so we don't have the time to wait. So I close my presentation, and during the questions, we can return to this to see if the scenario was successful or not. So we've seen this session was fully powered, let's say, by the community. So via this way, I would like to thank everybody who was involved in one of these community frameworks. You see there are a lot of framework around. I didn't use them all because there are still other frameworks available. And yeah, that means something. That means that application lifecycle management is very hard to handle, and yeah, that the out-of-the-box features that we get within BizTalk are not sufficient. So that's why there's a lot of community frameworks available. So thanks to everybody. Without all this community effort, this session was not possible. So I guess it's now time for the questions, if there are any.